we are always looking for better performance. And when it comes to performance, we are always trying to have the best optimization that is possible at the software level. So how can we do that? And we'll look at a few other things. So things I'll be covering will be compiler optimizers and the overhead of optimizations, as in compiler optimizations, and what when we are writing our code, what we should keep in mind to get better performance, and some of the profiling tools so that we can measure the performance of the application. Moving forward, since I'm going to start with the compiler optimizers, before I talk about the specific optimizers, let's just look at the phases, how it works. So when we write high-level language code, we compile it into an executable file. So what happens in between from your high-level language code between you compile it to get executable code? There are various phases during this process that happens. And first is it converts your code into some intermediate representations, which is independent of your machine architectures. And then on that, it does a first level of optimization. And there are various passes, obviously, in that. In the first level of optimization itself, it does a lot of changes to get better performance, and only if you enable pass on the optimization flags to the compiler. And then it converts your code into machine-independent intermediate representations. In GCC, we have this RTL representations. I'll not get into the specifications of this intermediate representations, but RTL is the machine independent intermediate representation when you compile it using GCC. And then it does optimization at second level optimization at this level, and then you get your assembly code. Here in the diagram, I have not included, but after assembly code, assembler comes in, which compiles your code further, and I mean, it converts it further to object codes, and then you have link time optimization as well. So there are three levels of optimizations that can happen. Now, talking about the first level of optimization, I'll talk about some of the examples here. So first is common sub-expression elimination. So as you can see, we have two expressions here, K and R. In both the expression, this I plus J is common. And I and J values of these two variables are not changing in between these two expressions. So we can eliminate it, compute the value before I plus J, and use that like this. We are doing I plus J, saving it somewhere, and then using it in these two expressions. So that way you do the I plus J computation only once and not twice for both the expression. Now second is function inlining. So in this we have one function square, which is doing nothing but taking one variable and multiplying it to itself and returning it. So it's just calculating the square of the argument passed to it. And then from some other function, say for example main or any other function defined in your program, we have a for loop, which is iterating over a huge range. And in each iteration, it adds 0.5 to your iterator and takes the square of that and adds it to a variable sum and adding up everything. So instead of, when there is a function call, you have to, at the compilation level, at the runtime, there is a new stack frame that has to be created. And the control flow has to jump to a new address, which will be the address of the square function. So there's a lot of thing happens. So to avoid the overhead of doing that, we can inline the function if it is possible. And within the for loop itself, we will do sum plus equal to in bracket I plus 0.5 into I plus 0.5. We can do that. But again, we are doing I plus 0.5 twice, so we just take it out to compute it once and then do sum plus equal to the variable where we are in storing I plus 0.5. So we inline the function to avoid the overhead of calling another function. Then we have loop unrolling. Here, the inside the loop, we have a Y array, and we are assigning the values, which is same as to the index of the array. So it is pretty simple and straightforward. So we know that for every index of the array, we have the same as to index, we have to assign the value. So instead of looping over it, we can just take it out and do it in this format. Obviously, the array is not very long here, so we can write this code. And even if we don't write it, compiler will do it if we do this optimization over our code. So what happens that in every iteration, you are avoiding this initialization, incrementation, and check. Initialization anyways happened once, but you are avoiding incrementation and this check in every iteration. Next is loop invariant code motion. In this example, we have a for loop. Inside this loop, we have x is equal to y plus z, and the value of y plus z is not changing anywhere inside this loop. And then you are doing this computation. Sorry. This ai is equal to 7 plus I into x plus x. So x is also not changing anywhere. So this part does not have any role here to be inside the loop. We can take it out. And x is also not changing within the loop, so we can take that out as well. So whatever is not varying inside the loop, we can take that out so that the computation happened only once, and we are not doing the same computation in every iteration. So only if the variables don't change, we can do this kind of things. Then we have loop peeling. In loop peeling, we try to kind of vectorize it in a format that it can run parallelly. So the idea to do it is parallelize the computation. Now, if we talk about compiler optimizers, there are three levels of optimizations. One, and the flags are -01, -02, -03. So there are three levels of optimization possible, and there are many optimizers that I'm going to show the examples. So in first level, mostly we have the optimization that are happening are machine independent optimization. In second level, mostly the optimization happening are combination of machine independent and machine dependent. Third level are pretty advanced, and it's mostly machine dependent. So this is kind of machine dependent optimization, and because we do it to parallelize it. So here we try to take out some of the iterations which makes it parallelization make it impossible. So here if we look at the current state, like only if p is equal to I is assigned, then only the next iteration of this thing can happen, this computation, yi initialization of this y array at that index. So what we are doing is, say, for example, we have an array of 20 size. So we are taking sum of the current index and its previous index. So for the first, we have to take it like that in a manner that p is initialized to 20 and I plus p, and we are maintaining two variables. If we take the first computation out, it is possible to just use one variable. So this makes it possible to parallelize because we have a dependency of just one variable here. And it does not need to, since there is only one statement, it does not need any other statement to be executed before the next can be executed. Then we have dead code and store elimination. So here in this example, we have a variable called b, which is not used anywhere actually. And if we look at this code, here we are returning c, and there is no condition to it. And even after that, we have two statements. So that is redundant, so we can directly remove it. In further iteration, it can probably recognize that B is anyways not used, so even this can be removed. Then we have copy propagation transformation, in which it is just trying to see that there is a variable y in which we are assigning the value of x, and then we are doing this computation 3 plus y. So y is pretty redundant here, we could have directly said 3 plus x, and that simplifies the operation. Then we have jump threading. Here in we have two conditions we are checking. So A is less than 0. So if that comes out to be false, obviously A is going to be greater than or equal to 0. So we did not need to do this second if operation. It could have been avoided, and we could have just do an else statement. So these kind of things can be avoided. But when we are writing the code, we miss out on these things and we write that. So it's better to be careful when we write the code itself. But if we don't, you can use the compiler optimizers to get these kind of optimizations done. Then we have loop vectorization. Again, this is a machine dependent kind of optimization wherein the vectors are created. The normal simple arrays is split into vectors. Now, for this kind of thing to happen, your architecture need to have SIMD support. Only then it makes sense. So you break the entire thing into vectors. And say, for example, you have four processors. So the four of them could be parallelly run on different processors. And that is what happens in loop vectorization. But it's helpful only when your system has support for such things. Then we have peephole optimization. It just it again works on machine dependent optimization and machine dependent intermediate representation. So only when after your code is converted into assembly code, it tries to see if there are any redundant stack instructions which can be removed. So here we have A is equal to B plus C, and then D is equal to A plus E. So there are move operations happening here. B is moved to R0, C, and then C is added to R0. So and then in we are moving R0 into A variable. Then again, for this operation, first A is being moved into R0. But the previous operation, we already moved R0 value to A. So this was pretty much redundant here. In R0, we anyway have the same value right now. We are overwriting it with the same value. So we could have removed this. So that's what is happening here. So I have just drawn this chart based on a very simple example wherein I was doing over, say, 10,000 iterations, and I was taking some of the square of every single value. So with that kind of simple program with with O0, which is with no optimization, it took this much time. With O1, it comes down significantly, and with O2, O3, it pretty much gave me the same output. So this was a very simple program. You just considered our softwares are pretty huge. So in those, if you do the optimization, it makes significant difference. So that is when you use compiler optimizers. But the downside of it is if you do compiler optimizers, obviously there are so many optimization passes happening. I just gave you the examples of very few ones. There are so many of them. And it takes longer to compile. And when you come across a problem, we always have bugs in our code. So if you hit on a bug or a situation which is unlikely, undesirable, you tend to load it in GDB and debug it. So that time it happens that you have optimized code. You try to get the value of a variable in your program, and it says the value is optimized out. So you don't really get to see, and it becomes a little bit difficult to map it to your source code. But you can still do it looking at the assembly code if you are comfortable with it, but mapping it directly with your source code becomes a little bit tricky when you are debugging it. So when this was about when you do the compiler optimizers, now, what are the things we should be taking care of when we are writing our code, knowing, having looked at some of the examples? So the very main part of it comes like load and store are very heavy operations. So knowing how your memory hierarchy is and how it works comes very handy and helpful to write very optimal code and get better performance. So we know registers are part of your processor, then comes cache, and then memory, and then obviously your program source code resides on disk. So when you run it, the first three part of it is coming into picture, and the size of it is less at the top level, but the speed is higher. So you have the limitation of size up there. So you should write your code in a way so that you are using most use of registers. Then you should try to access your data in a way that there are maximum cache hits rather than misses. We'll just have a simple example here to come to that point. And accessing anything from memory is very expensive in terms of time. So you should see how you can minimize that. So here I have an example for that, which is swap operation in using two methods. In the first method, I'm just initializing a temporary variable. In that variable, I'm saving the first variable that is passed to it, then just do the swap operation. So basically, point is I'm introducing a new variable. So new variable gets pushed onto your stack, and that is how it works. So you are, in a way, kind of accessing your memory here, making one extra memory reference. In this example, here, you are not creating any extra variable. You are just doing XOR operations to get the value swapped. So you still you have only two memory references. With that, you are doing arithmetic operations to get the value swapped. So this is more efficient in terms of time and performance than this one, because of the extra memory accesses that are going to happen here. So these are the kind of things we can think of when writing code. What are the alternate ways to do the things that we want to achieve, and what will fetch you the best performance? Then comes the profiling part. For any memory profiling, you can use Valgrind. For time-based profiling, as in how it's doing in terms of time, you can use perf. And memory profiling, if I say in terms of performance, I would be mostly trying to check the cache grind to see how many cache misses are happening, cache hits are happening, and what I can do to get it better. So here, Valgrind, cache grind, this is how you run. Valgrind tool is equal to cache grind, then you specify your executable. Here I have a small example. Say you have a multi-dimensional array with R number of rows and C number of columns, and here I'm accessing it with first I, that is row, and then column. And then column gets incremented, that is this way. And when you create a multi-dimensional array, this element comes first, and in the next memory location, this goes. So when you access the first element, say you are reading from this array, then the chances is that all the next, whatever is the cache capacity, it will try to pull that many data from the array, put it into the cache, so that next iteration, whatever data you are reading, you are going to have a cache hit, and you don't need to read it from the memory. Whereas in this example, it's reading the K is your iterating over column. So you are putting the column part first and then the row part. So it's going this way. Read operation is happening in this manner. So you read the first element. It brings in the data. Say the cache had the limit of whatever is your row column count, say C, had the capacity of C only. It pulled it up to here. But in the next iteration, you are reading this. So there is a cache miss. And again, it pulled all this data up to this, and again, next iteration, there is a cache miss. So there, in every read, you are having a cache miss. And so it will try, so there is two things happening. For every cache miss, it will try to update the cache, and ultimately, to get the data, it will have to read it from the memory. So that brings in a lot of overhead and extra time. So you can minimize it by doing it, seeing how you should be accessing over your array elements to get the better performance. And for the perf part, specifying the perf we've got here, hyphen E will give you a record of what is happening in the user space of your program. So here I get, with the same example that I mentioned earlier, I get this output. So maximum time, CPU time is taken in this function, that is sum here. So maybe if I'm not very happy with the performance or overall time of the program, since the maximum time is going in this function, my first attempt would be to open the code of the sum function and check what is happening there and what I can do to get a better performance. Then GCC optimizations, you can use this command, GCC hyphen C hyphen hyphen help is equal to optimizers, to list, get the complete list of optimizers that are available with compilers. And with this command, you specifically get what are the, out of all those optimizers, what are the ones which is enabled at hyphen O2 level. And similarly, here you can hyphen, instead of hyphen O2, you can use hyphen O1, hyphen O3 to get a list of what are enabled at different levels. And this is the LLVM command to get the list of optimizers with LLVM. That's all. Do we still have time? Sorry? 5 minutes. Okay. Any questions so far? Or I'll just, since. So you can see here the list of optimizers, and there's one liner explanation to what all optimizers are there. And if I do, one thing here is that even with no optimizer, that is hyphen O0, when you don't really are optimizing your code implicitly, there are some of them which are still enabled. So you see here, it says enabled, and some other ones are also enabled. So even if the binaries that we have in Fedora, RHEL, or any other distros, they are mostly non-optimized source code, binaries. So even with that, when you are doing some kind of debugging, sometimes you try to print some value and it says optimized, because some of the optimizers are enabled by default. So if I want to see what happens when I'm optimizing my code, when I'm compiling it with GCC, obviously. Here right now I have these three files, four files, dc.o. And if I compile it with this option, let's say I call font. Is it fine? Okay. Sorry? Okay. So here, since I compiled just to an object file, you notice there are certain files are generated, and compiler gives you the number dc.c original, then gimple. So gimple is the first level intermediate representation with GCC, and this number tells you which pass happened after which. So this is the first that happened, And with numbering, you can trace. In between, there are some passes which probably with the flags I passed on were not triggered. There are so many passes. And they are, you know, brought into picture only with certain flags that you used when during compilation. So with with no flag in place, with fdump tree all, I just got the passes that are happening. If I do here a first level optimization, you will see there are a lot more passes happening here, and it gets you the output of all of them. And you can trace back like what was the output at this level and what changed between these two. So it is with GCC, it's very fairly simple to track down what kind of changes are happening in which pass. And if you noticed earlier with this command, help optimizers, it gives you the name of the optimizers like CDCE and FDCE. Is here. So you can see here in the output, there will be some DCE will be there at the end of it. That is how you will know that it is output of DCE optimizer, and you can, you know, track down what changes are happening at each level of pass with compilation. And that was with F3. Fdump tree all, it gives you the output of, passes output of all the first level optimizers, which is machine independent. There is something called fdump RTL all, and there is something called fdump IPA all. With IPA all, you get the output of, link time optimizer. With RTL all, you get the dump of all the machine dependent changes that are happening. So it becomes easy for you to drag down and see all the changes. Thanks, everyone. Any questions?
If you have questions, keep them offline outside, please.
Okay. We're running out of time. Feel free to catch me offline if you have any questions.